space distribution.
Welcome, Golden Speakers Toastmasters of Fairfield. We meet every Tuesday at the Hy-Vee Club Room, Hy-Vee on West Burlington, and we're on the west side of the store at the end of the ice cream aisle. Welcome to everyone here. The mission of a Toastmasters Club is to provide a mutually supportive and positive learning environment in which every member has the opportunity to develop oral communication and leadership skills, which in turn foster self-confidence and personal growth. So that's the path that we're on, that's the track that we're on for tonight. All right, so we have everybody, Mr. Miller, you're the general evaluator, excellent. Okay. So our agenda is a little bit adjusted because of some last minute problems that people had for getting here, but we'll just go ahead and we'll roll with it. We actually needed a little extra time because Will is coordinating with our division director, Ben Traxel, on the contest that we're going to be the site host for next week. So it's all good. With that, I want to invite up our Toastmaster for the evening, which happens to be me. Okay, I actually need an agenda. Is there an agenda that I could have? Just realized I was up here without one. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. We're going to go right through our role players and have them explain what they're going to be doing. Give us a little bird's eye view. Let's start with our timer, and that will be Emery Styron.
I am the timer, and I will be timing table topics, which are 1 to 2 minute speeches. The yellow light comes on at 1 minute 30 seconds. The green light comes on at 1 minute, the yellow light at 1 minute 30 seconds, the red light at 2 minutes, and remains on till the end of the speech. Prepared speeches, speech in this case tonight, 5 to 7 minutes, maybe it's longer in this case, I'm not sure. What is your speech length, Stuart?
5 to 7 minutes.
Okay, good. Green light comes on at 5, yellow light on at 6, red light on at 7. Evaluations are 3 minutes, green light on at 2 minutes, yellow light on at 2 minutes 30 seconds, red light turned on in 3 minutes. I'll be giving a report at the end of the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's just a reminder here on clapping. And I know it's hard to juggle everything in your lap sometimes, so sometimes your hands are anchoring what's in your lap. We don't have desks, but it's really helpful and important to encourage our people that are up here and our role players to be clapping, so do your clapping. I want to mention real quickly, last week we kicked off the youth leadership program for, we've got 15, 16 kids in it. Andal has been extremely helpful. She organized and recruited the students into the program. I said I would teach it if you'll bring the students. And she contacted the middle school, and we have kids coming in that I've never seen before, or parents, any of that. It's very exciting, very wonderful. The reason I bring that up is that our very first class, we were talking about how to clap. Good clapping, bad clapping. They loved it. And the clapping in that group from the very get-go has been very professional. You may not have heard clapping referred to as being professional, but that's what we're going for, professional clapping. Nothing but the best for our members. Okay. Our next role player is our grammarian, and that is going to be Art Atkinson.
Tonight, Toastmasters, I volunteer for the role of grammarian, and in my brand new, fresh, competent leader manual, one of the projects that calls for evaluation for role as a grammarian is project number one, listening. Is there someone in the room that can evaluate my performance as a grammarian tonight? Thank you, Emery. I'll bring you this manual. My role has two aspects. One is to listen for particularly beautiful or particularly awkward use of English and to comment about that, give a report at the end. The other is to choose a word of the evening. I've chosen the word vanquish in consideration of our theme competition. The vanquish means to triumph or win or subjugate. It has the connotation of, in war, subjugating an enemy. You know, one would vanquish an enemy. And an illustration in a sentence would be, in the competition for invitation, excellence, and golden speakers amongst the club members, he vanquished all of the other members. That is my role, and I'll comment. I'll give a report at the end of the evening.
Okay. Very topical sentence there as an example. Thank you for reminding me. Competent leader manuals. Let's see them.
I gotta buy one today.
You're gonna buy one. Okay. Everyone. I know, I have been told that it's easier to face evil people than to face me. Okay, yes, good. All right, so it looks like everybody has competent leader manuals. So what we will do, Art got the ball rolling. At the end, we want everyone to, and you know, you'll be handing your manual and helping somebody else because we're all gonna be overlapping that way, but you want to get your role signed off on in your competent leader manual if you have a role, and everybody has a role. So that's going to be cool. We might just go everybody pass to the left or something. Okay, so you want to make sure though you know which project you're going to be evaluated for. I'm so excited. I've got my third one now. I'm just about done with two, and I'm going to start a third one because I never want to do a role without getting credit for it. I feel wealthy. Wealthy and competent leaders. Okay, our next role player is our op counter, our filler word counter, and that will be Pia. And Pia, will you tell us what you'll be doing?
In this role, I'll be counting the number of filler words that each person for the role has. And that is, like, you know, so, but, and, a tongue click, Xerox, and false start. And then I'll give her 1 minute report at the end.
Good. All right. This is the first time you've done this, is that right? Oh, you're going to be in for just a wake up. You listen to all of this. Our general evaluator, whom we'll hear from later in the evening, will be Ryan Prana Miller. And our greeter and joke master, and Duard, we have you multitasking. So are you prepared with you've got a joke that you can?
Possibly two. Both unacceptable.
Okay, well, this is a GP? What is it? The G?
We can always edit it.
Yes. It's like Monty Python English stuff.
This needs to be, like, a child could hear this.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Good. We've had some that were not that way, and it's our poor audience at home just has to deal with it.
Necessary.
Okay. All right. Okay, there we go. All right. Those are all of our role players. Now we're going to turn over to our prepared speech for the evening. And that is going to be Duard Straub. And I'm going to hand off to his evaluator to tell us about the objectives for Duard's speech. And his evaluator is Will Burns.
Thank you, Jean. Duard is doing project number three, make him laugh. Now, this is a daunting task for any mortal man, but I think Dewart's up to the challenge. His executive, or my executive summary for his speech. Humor is an ideal way to attract and hold an audience's attention. You can use humor to build rapport, emphasize points, convey a sensitive subject, or deal with unexpected incidents that occur during your talk. Humor involves some kind of unexpected twist that pleasantly surprises the audience or horrifies them. His goal is to practice delivering this material until he can do it smoothly, pausing before the punchline to create tension. Now, Dewart Straub is a man whose mere name on this sheet causes competition to be vanquished, to disappear. He is our sole speaker tonight. He was born and raised in Nome, Alaska. And as a child, he enjoyed fishing, bicycling, and watching adults behave foolishly. Busy activity, indeed. As a young man, he met many amusing people while working for the Alaska Gold Company. Some are featured in his talk tonight. His speech is entitled, Me, Ike, and Leo, a Belligerent Trio. Please join me in welcoming Dewart Straub.
Greetings, fellow Toastmasters, would-be guests, and viewers at home. To be vanquished during the course of the evening by a substance or a competitor is never the goal. Nonetheless, it happens. I met Leo and Ike at the Alaska Gold Company a few miles outside my hometown of Nome. We were perpetually hungover. We worked from spring until fall in our yellow rain gear. And some days, as we were flushing the earth, imagine just rows and rows and rows, miles of green metal pipe and 60 feet of steel pipe into the earth, and us out there, ill, flushing the earth with these. It would thaw a bit, we'd run the tube in. Sometimes we'd be nodding off at the post, and then the straw boss would come by and give us a nudge or invite us over on a slower day for the pipe wrench toss. It was a well-to-do company, and so the goal was to see how close to the opening, and as the points, we called them points, we flushed the earth so that a large landridge could come and dig it up. Imagine a giant cow, and the bucket ladder by itself weighed 900 tons, and so you had these buckets on it that a person could sit in, and it would just dig up this earth, and it would run it into a huge screen that was always cycling and would throw the finer dirt on either side in the sluice boxes where the gold was collected. And the heavier stuff would go up a stacker belt out and create these tailing piles. So it is like a large cow. That's kind of how we thought about it. Leo. He had bifocals and a square head. He was constantly stoned into the occult and the darkest, heaviest music. Ike was very tall and quiet, with glasses as well, and had a poof of very white hair that he kept pressed under a hat, and his nickname was Cotton. And I appear almost exactly the same, except my hair was all one length, and about down here. After a particularly grueling day, we decided, no variation in the routine, let's go to the liquor store as soon as they drop us off downtown, and then we'll get in a cab, and we'll go to Ike's apartment. Fantastic! So, we get there, and immediately, Ron is there. Ike's perpetual house guest, who was always there because his marriage was a disaster, or his marriage was a disaster because he was always there. And he helps us eagerly carry the beer in, and before we could get it into the fridge, he is sucking one down. Thank you, Ron. Immediately, I'm presented with a gift from Leo. Stuart, I have what you're looking for. So this is the autobiography of a saint, Audacious, of Aleister Crowley. And he did it in a very special way when he was very excited to give a gift. It's evil. And he had to run his hand over it. And so I took it and I brought it to the cupboard so it wouldn't end up with a footprint. Or when the liquor got into people and they were more religious minded or adhered to conventional religious tradition, I wouldn't want it to exit the building, be destroyed in any way. A fascinating conversation about religion, women, and wildlife ensued. Ike and Ron were avid hunters when they weren't blasting their minds. My responses were inhibited by Ron, who kept bumping into me at the most interesting points of the conversation. When he wasn't bumping into me, I was trying to keep him from falling over onto a glass coffee table. We were running low on beer, so Leo decides, but we have plenty of hard liquor. Leo decides, well, I will go to the store. Excellent. He will cab away to the store. He goes off. Ike is concerned because Leo has been acting out. He used to have a huge crush on my ex-girlfriend, Dana. And Iken's real quiet voice said, you know, I'm doing a rail out in the Anchor Tavern the other night. And it's my buckskin outfit, and I thought it was looking pretty good. But Bernard was drawing all this attention to himself because he thought your ex-girlfriend was in town and trying to call him. So he was crazy. And the Anchor Tavern is a long hallway. People seated at the bar on one side, and then tables bolted to the side of the wall on the other side. And he said he was just crashing up against the wall, you know, Dana's trying to call me. Dana's trying to call me. And they physically threw him out of the building, go away. So we were concerned about his return. So we were dilly-dallying, oh God, so you can hear he come, we see out the window, he's in the cab. I said, I better talk to him because if he's gonna misbehave and drink up all the liquor to boot, I don't know if this is a good idea. So Ike says, well, I'll meet him at the door. And the door opens, he says, let me take this beer, I got something to tell you in the hallway. So he takes the beer and closes the door. And so Bernard is, as the Southern people would say, as mad as a hornet. So he runs all the way outside. The door locked immediately, and so he's outside, he's jumping up and down and probably cursing us in Latin or German or whatever he was learning at the time, because he was into the bazaar and the occult. Well, I finally talked everybody into letting him back. Let's just let him in here, and we'll drink ourselves into oblivion, and it'll all hash out. It'll be fantastic. So the next morning, I awoke on Ike's new ceiling fan, much like this, a rotating fan, and I step over Ron and Leo, and I look up, and Ike. This is the first thing I see, mind you, he's white as a ghost. He says, now I want to tell you something, who covered me with baby powder? I'm covered from head to toe, and this is foul language, and it's ridiculous. And so, I was really too nauseated to appreciate the humor, full humor of the situation. But we tried to piece together the evening, and it was hopeless, but I did learn that one shouldn't sleep on a ceiling fan.
Two more.
The end.
Two good ends, my froze. Oh, I got to get up here. My. Very good. Mr. Timer, could you please give us 2 minutes of silence? Oh, hey. Since he's our only 3 minutes. That was quite amusing. Jerry Seinfeld is what comes to mind. Dewar can tell a story about guys basically hanging out And it's just so hysterical in the details. With the, and usually there's some substance which is involved, and that makes it even more hysterical. That is our speech for tonight. I lost my agenda again. Okay, well, good, thank you. Is that where it went?
Yeah.
Okay.
I was nervous having to make you work.
So let's just make sure that Dewar qualified.
I think I timed out. It's on the red line. I think I went over.
Yes, Dewar did qualify.
He did qualify.
My second
okay. Excellent. All right, so that's the thing. Even though he is our one speaker, qualifying via time is what keeps you in or out of the competition. Even though you didn't have to vanquish anybody, you have to vanquish the clock. Exactly. We are going to have an evaluator. Do you feel you have enough time?
Let's do it, Jean.
Okay.
We'll find out.
First, we're going to call up our general evaluator who will handle this portion.
Toastmasters guests who are missing and viewers at home. We are now into the portion of our meeting where we get to evaluate the speakers, and that first speaker and the only speaker will be evaluated by Will Burns, and he has something to tell us about how Dewar met his objectives. Will Burns.
Time to say it in here, so I'll dive right in here. Dewar's speech was to make him laugh. Did you all feel like you had some laughs tonight?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
All right. And that's those laughs that I heard to my left and to my right, mostly to my left, indicated to me that the audience was entertained. And what made the speech humorous? Well, when it's humorous, is that Dewar has the ability to take these stories from his life and then convey them in an entertaining, inspiring, shocking way. How well did the jokes and stories fit the theme of the talk? I'm going to segue slightly. One of the objectives or one of the aspects in this speech is to separating from a story or a joke the theme and the peg. Any story has a theme. I'm going to hear from the manual. The essential point to the story and a peg in which the context of that theme is presented. So for me, I wasn't sure, but I thought that the theme tonight was friendship or a shared pursuit of oblivion. And the peg that I found was a day working for the Alaska Gold Company. However, I wasn't sure that was the exact theme, and that's why I have a question about the jokes and stories. So I look forward to talking with you, Dewar, after the meeting about that. I feel like you had a lot of great humor in the speech. I do feel like my suggestion would be, actually, it goes to setup. For example, you mentioned the Anchor Tavern, it seemed like an interesting place. You were diving in there, and then you backed up and said, oh, actually, yeah, it was a big sort of long, rectangular one. So my suggestion is, when you practice this, kind of find ways to work its layout into sort of the setup, and then there you are. But you had a number of characters. I was figuring there'd be three characters. We got, five. I got Leo, Ike, yourself, Ron. I think Bernard's another one. And accidentally said his real name. Oh, oh, okay.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
why. That's
yeah, that's fine. Yeah, I kind of think I made a busy character or not. I wasn't sure. But you seemed very comfortable up here, very confident. And I thought you used great body language and vocal variety. My suggestion wasn't just, you know, work a little bit on the setup there, but I love the elements of it. You know, you wake up and, oh my God, there's your friend covered in baby powder. Imagine how blinding it is, you know. And so, thank you, Dewar.
Thank you.
Competition, so I have some quotes, some questions, some observations to trigger for you an extemporaneous speech. It's your chance to come to the front of the room, vanquish your fears of talking without preparation. And I have to admit that I left all my questions at home, but it's always good to have a backup. So somehow we'll make it through, if I can read this tiny print. But the first thing we need is a volunteer. Who is eager? Too shy. Ronan.
I can volunteer?
Sure. Go
yeah,
for it.
I can volunteer.
Yeah. Yeah.
How'd you get on the road?
Competition.
Competition. So why don't you give me a number of 1 to 7?
4.
I've got this question for you. Do humans overdo the behavior of competing with one another? Please explain.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Very competitive person. I like to play tennis and I like to win at tennis, but I usually don't. So I think I'm competitive. It doesn't mean that people I know are competitive, but in general, there are competitive people and there are not competitive people. And as a race, the human race, I guess, I think a lot of our problems come from competition of resources like oil and coal and natural gas and propane and maybe eventually water. So in America, we kind of live in this abundant resource, you know, and we have electricity, we have cars all over the map, you know, we've got more roads than we can fill with cars, which is a good thing. But I think competition, I'm going to take this away from like sports and typical competition, because I think competition for resources is the main thing that we're competing for right now. And you know, in MUM we have a sustainable university, everyone's all about solar power and everything like that. So it's competition, we're overly competitive, yes, and I think if we conserve resources, we will have a better, more fair mindset towards each other, towards our resources. And yeah, I think competition of resources isn't really like a, what am I trying to say? We need to reduce our not greed. Greed's an overly used word, kind of cliche, greed, but we have more resource addiction, I think, than as a country than we need. So yes, we are too competitive with our resources. And the solution is unknown right now, but it's a work in progress. So, sustainability. Thank you.
Who else would like to come? I think we probably have time tonight for maybe 5 or 6 people. So, a lot of you can participate. Art. I've got 1 to 7, we've used 4 already.
Fine.
This is a quote, I had to throw in a baseball quote. This is from Joe Torre, who was the very successful Yankees manager. Competing at the highest level is not about winning. It's about preparation, courage, understanding, and nurturing your people and heart. Winning is the result.
Good evening, Toastmasters, viewers at home. What I know about baseball would fit into a very small container. The usual metaphor is a thimble. But the quote that you read to me from this team manager resonates with what I was thinking about as you asked the last question about competition. And I thought about the tradition in Asian martial arts, which is to honor the opponent, honor the competitor. It is the caliber of the competitor which brings out the best in the artist, the martial artist. If you have a weak competitor, you don't really shine and do your best. So at the end of a martial arts combat or competition, the two opponents bow to each other, regardless of who was the winner in the competition. The quote that you gave me from the team manager reminds me of a correction of a quote. There's a famous quote that winning isn't everything. No, see, you would know this better than I.
Winning isn't everything.
It's the only thing.
And the correction, this was the famous Green Bay Packer coach. He said the correction, he was misquoted, it was winning isn't everything, wanting to win is the only thing. He distinguished between high caliber competition and winning at all costs. Winning wasn't everything in his mind. It was the preparation, the nurturing of his team members. All of the preparation that you were describing that that baseball manager held to be the highest values, he was echoing the same. So my opinion is that competition is one of the ways in which the human race actually shines the best. Certainly it happens in sports, but in the field of resource management, it's the competition to find new resources and new ways of using better resources that makes us shine the best. Mr. Table.
All right. Jean has a suggestion, it looks like.
I'd like to move that.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, there's several seconds. Come on up here.
She was going to volunteer.
Yeah.
We have Russian volunteers.
We 1 through 7, we used 4 and 5.
Okay, 2.
If you want to succeed in anything, it is essential that you set high standards for yourself. These standards must be defined by you, not your family, not your friends, but you. Only you know what you are capable of. Be brave and be bold. Your thoughts.
I find this to be an interesting quote because I feel like as a person, I've always been pretty self-motivated. When I was younger, I would stay up late doing my homework, and then my parents would come and see me up late doing my homework, and they'd be like, "What are you doing? Just go to bed." So I was very determined to get it done, even if it was math homework, which I found endlessly frustrating. But it's interesting to see different people's internal motivations. Sometimes you really want to get something done and different levels of motivation lead to difficult situations. But I think internal motivation is what inspires us to do our hobbies or other activities, because there's no external drive. Like, you could just sit at home and watch TV all afternoon, but are you going to do something? So I think that's where a lot of inspiring stories in people's lives take place. Like, what do you do with your time when no one is telling you what to do with it? And I think that's why get to know you questions are usually like, well, what do you do in your free time? And I think that tells a lot about a person. And
vote about Jean coming up. Jean. We have one. Comparing yourself to others is a worthless cause. While competition can provide for some solid motivation every now and then, the truth is, your only competition is you. Your thoughts. Pay attention. Comparing yourself to others is a worthless cause. While competition can provide some solid motivation every now and then, the truth is, your only competition is you.
Fellow Toastmasters, viewers at home, I've thought a lot about adulting since last week when I first heard that word from our new member, Pia. I actually asked our youth leadership program the next night if they were familiar with this term, and they weren't, but they're a little younger, so I said, you heard it here, you're going to become familiar with adulting. Why am I bringing up adulting? In relation to this quote, I believe that part of adulting behavior, can you use it as a verb? Adulting behavior is when you start looking more internally at what are your motivators and what are your drivers, as opposed to taking cues from the outside, which by definition is always changing and may or may not be in sync with who you are and what you want. I think it is true that your internal competition with you and between you and you is really the key for improvement throughout your life, because everywhere you go for your entire life, you're going to be along for the ride. if that makes sense. You are always with you. So what better motivator and guide, and because you are you, they know you, it knows you pretty well and vice versa, what better guide to give you input into what you ought to be doing and how far you can be reaching and how far you can go. And I think that's adulting, actually. As you get older, and we all are, I think part of the process is that the things that you used to think were important and things that you needed to strive for start to fall away as not really being all that important. And the parts that are important, according to you, from living a life of wisdom with yourself, become more prominent. So it actually gets easier as you get older because the extraneous stuff slips away. And that is great. And that's when you vanquish all the outside stuff and you become a winner for yourself.
I've got two more questions and I think we have time for both. I think Emery is feeling the need to come up there. I just have the feeling.
Great.
Do you want the lower number or the higher number?
Higher.
Do you think that competition with others in our society spurs us on to greater achievements? Please give examples. I certainly do believe that competition spurs me individually to greater effort and sometimes achievement. And good evening, fellow Toastmasters, viewers, to give the example that comes to mind, the quickest. I'm a swimmer. I go to our local rec center and swim laps two or three times a week. Often I'm in the pool by myself early in the morning, but sometimes there's another swimmer. Now, I don't know if any of you have ever swim laps, but sometimes you get going about stroke for stroke with the person in the next lane, and you inevitably begin to compete. And so that makes me swim faster. In business and work, many, many times, I was an insurance agent years ago, and the company would have a contest among agents in different offices who can sell the most life insurance policies. I didn't care a thing about selling life insurance, but for the sake of a contest, I got out and did it. And in many other sales situations, competition spurred me onward. Whether competition among governments, societies is a healthy thing, that's another question. But I know for me individually, competition spurs me onward. Mr. Table Topics Master. Chance, last question. I think maybe Will or Duard.
No,
Adal. Oh, she's Adal evaluating.
Oh, okay.
So we're going to hear from her extensively.
I'm too shy.
Yeah, we believe that. So we'll work.
I need to practice. frame.
Okay.
All right. What you got?
Please relate an experience regarding a competition in which you weren't the winner, but took away a positive lesson.
Let's see. What competitive event did I take place or did I compete in recently? Well, 2 weeks ago, I competed in the club 75-15 contest, and I was happy to place in both events I competed in, but I got vanquished for the ultimate prize in both. I think there's a big takeaway that I had the pleasure or the experience of being bested by Raven Garland in the inspirational speech contest, and I had the distinct privilege of being bested by Raven and Deward in the table topics competition. And my big takeaway was to do more. I came up here and I couldn't out Deward. I couldn't do big enough gestures. I couldn't do enough excitement. But I didn't even outwill myself. I didn't even push myself to do anything, to really, you know, wave my arms, to really take the energy, the excitement, the inside of myself and push it to really share with you, the audience, what I was feeling and what was going on in my story. I didn't have the structure that Raven did in the inspirational speech. And I didn't have the earth-shaking gestures, the movement, and so all my pain was inside. But now I can stand in front of you today and tell you that hearken unto me. There is a lesson here. Be yourself. Take that self that is inside of you. Bring it out. Thank you.
I think that's going to conclude our competition. Mr. Timer, can you tell us which of the table topic speakers qualified?
All of our speakers qualified. They are Prana, Art, Pia, Jean, Emery, and Will.
Let's find our voting slips and take a minute to vote. Okay, now that we've voted, it's time for us to hear an evaluation. Andal is going to evaluate table topics and tell us what she heard people do well and what she thinks that people could do to improve. So please welcome Andal Christian.
Good evening, Toastmasters, guests at home. Tonight I'm going to evaluate the table topics speakers. We have six good speakers here tonight. We had, well, first one was Prana. He took his time to get ready mentally for his speech. Then he had a good start. He spoke about tennis, how it was competitive in his life and how he liked playing tennis, and then he moved to the human race, comparing how it was it is competitive within among the human race. His conversation was good. He moved on the stage, and his start and ending was good because he started with his own experience, and then he came back to sustainable living. That was good. I would say, if any suggestion, I would say he could avoid repetitiveness of the same story. And next was art. He spoke about martial arts. Sorry, I'm not able to even read my own handwriting. I was trying to get all the points jotted down. So he was trying to explain the players, how competitive it is among the players, and wanting to win everything, and in a high caliber. And he was very much in coherent with the topic, and he had a good start and good ending, the way human race. And I liked the ending of his speech. His sentence was like, "Is one competition is one of the way human races shine." That was good. One suggestion I would say, he could go and use the stage more. Next was Pia. It was her first table topic, I guess. For a first table topic, she did amazingly good. She started with her personal story, which was, as an audience, it was, for me, I was more eager to listen to her. And she spoke about how internal motivation drive to the creativity in her. And I liked it. One suggestion, if I would say, is you could end it in a better way. If you feel that there are no more words, you can just end it and then take your seat. So it's a pausing. I've done that many times. It's a learning process. So that's one suggestion. Then it was Jean. She always jumps right into the topic. Experience all these years. I always look up to her. And she was very comfortable. She greeted when she started her speech, and then she had a good start, and she had a good conclusion. She had a good vocal voice volume, and she had a good hand gestures, and when she was explaining, like, fall away, she was moving her hands down and bringing her hands up. That was good. I don't have any suggestions for her. Next was Emery. After you started your speech, you realized that you had to greet the audience. That was good, I think, because sometimes we forget, I forget, and then I keep going. And one suggestion I would say is you could have your hand gestures instead of having it. You were quite having your hands here. Well, next is Will. His speech was more enthusiastic this time, because I've never seen him use the stage so much, but it was like he used the stage a lot. He used his hand movements, and he started his experience of how it went through the competition, trying to compare, and then he made it more funny. So that was good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for that clear, concise table talks review. Next, we have to talk about who qualified for the evaluation section of the meeting. And I think, Emery, can you tell us who qualified for the evaluators of the, what should be, M. Andal or Dan Craig?
No, not Will.
Or Will, I'm sorry, yeah.
One of those guys.
That's what it's going to be. Anybody that wants to volunteer to be evaluated.
Will qualify.
Will qualify. Okay, so let's vote for the best. We don't need to vote. Wonderful. That makes it easy. Say, sorry, you've been vanquished. Whoever. without. But there's always next week. Let's see. Okay, so the next part of our meeting is going to be me, I believe. Again, I'm here. I'm here to stay, unfortunately, so you have to deal with me. I'm going to move over to the camera. To the limelight. Okay. I am going to tell you, actually, I'd like to introduce the role players again and see what happened this evening. What do we got here? First, Embry, tell us the timer's report.
Thank you. Deward spoke for 7 minutes 24 seconds. Will's evaluation was 3 minutes 29 seconds. Table topics, Prana 213, Art 230, Pia 207, Jean 226, Emery 153, and Will 213. And all's table topics evaluation was 5 minutes 34 seconds.
Thank you.
My report.
Thanks, Emery. And how about Dan Craig? Could you give us the role player report for the grammarian?
It's actually Art.
Art. I'm sorry. Yes, wasn't paid in. Art.
Vanquished was popular this evening. Will used it twice, Jean twice, Dan once, and I may have missed some others. My apologies, Stewart used it.
I used it once.
Oh,
not, not during a speech, but.
I'm sorry?
I said I used it once, but not during a speech, so.
If I missed others, I'm sorry. Stewart had some memorable phrases in his talk. Perpetually hungover, bifocals and a square head to describe a Leo. And then there was a man whose life was a disaster because of his marriage, or maybe his marriage was a disaster because of his life. I thought that was, and then a belligerent trio. It was just full of colorful phrases. Will's evaluation included the brilliant description of a shared pursuit of oblivion. Thea said she talked about internal motivation, what you do when nobody is telling you what you have to do. Jean came up with the phrase adulting behavior, and wherever you go, you're along for the ride. And Will had the beautiful phrase, I had the pleasure of being bested by Raven and by Dewar. That's my report.
Okay, thanks, Art. Next, I'd like to hear from Pia. Please tell us your awe counter report.
So, I'm not 100% sure what qualifies, but I'll tell you what I thought I heard. I thought I heard two us from Emery. Prana had two ums, one so, one false start, and four other things that were like other filler words.
Sure. All right.
Stuff like that. Durad had one so, two false starts, I thought. Will had one and one so, and two sort ofs. Art had one, you know, and Andal had four us and two ums.
Okay, so at this point we are nearing the close of the meeting, but I will. Oh, I'm sorry, one more. Yes, we have a joke from Dewart. Sir, lighten us up.
Well, I have a minute, so I'm gonna throw a few things out there. I'm fascinated by last words, and they should be the best that we can come up with. Some, on the way out, words I find hilarious, fascinating. We'll go right to W.C. Fields because I can't think of the person who wrote The Picture of Dorian Gray. Shout it out. Okay, anyway. Crud. Anywho, W.C. Fields, noted for excessive alcohol consumption and he hated children. His friends found him at the end of his life thumbing through the Bible in this hospital bed. They said, "What are you doing?" He said, "I'm looking for a loophole." Voltaire, noted French philosopher, 18th century, I believe, he was on his way out and someone said, "Do you think you would like to consult a priest?" He said, "Oh, there's no sense in making enemies now." And to end, two nails were standing around talking. One gets distracted and looks away. And he turns around. He said, "Oh, I was just talking to my friend. I heard this loud bang." He's not there. Oscar Wilde.
Dorian Gray, yes. Yeah. I have a joke about deathbed cookies, but I'll save it for next week. Can't remember right now, but I'll save it for next week for the joke. If I'm the joke master next week, hint, hint, whoever's creating the
next
schedule.
Week is the area contest.
Oh, right. The week
yeah.
After. Okay. So, tonight I'm going to be reviewing the evaluation portion of the meeting of the evaluation. I'm evaluating the evaluators, and the first evaluator was Will, and I think you talked about the objectives that were met for Dewar's speech, and I think that was, you really followed the manual clearly. You talked about his objectives that he needed to add. Well, first of all, you asked us, the audience, did we enjoy a speech? Did you laugh? I laughed. Everyone this side of the room was laughing more than this side, so you were also kind of making us laugh. And so I like how you talked to us as audience participation. I think that's good. Keep us connected as an audience / speaker. You mentioned that Dewar used a lot of vocal variety, which I think he probably knows. He is very vocally varied. And your loud, booming voice, you know, you use your gestures, you talk to us about Will Dewar's speech, and I think you talked about content too, as opposed to like just talking about what his speech was as a whole, his vocal variety, his use of the stage. Well, I mean, in Toastmasters, you know, there's like certain criteria for a speech that we evaluate, but rather than just talking about the criteria, like vocal variety, stage use, stuff like that, you talked about content too, about the Alaskan gold miner rig that he worked on. So that was good, just talking about the content and his six friends that were originally three, turned into six, so. It was a fun story and very excessive story, but you managed to capture his main points and meet the objectives, whether or not he met the objectives. So, good evaluation. Next, since we lost three of our speakers tonight, if you're watching, I hope you're feeling okay wherever you are. If we missed you, come back next week. On Dahl, we go right to table topics. You had, you basically talked to each person, like as a, you focused on their eyes, you know, eye contact, which is good. You were very attentive and deliberate. You're slow speaking. You don't rush through the speeches, which I think is good. I really don't have any negative, any criticisms for you. I would just say, yeah, like I said, you talk to each person, you kind of reviewed what each person talked about during their speeches, like Pia's motivation, speech about internal versus external motivation. You talked about using the stage, which was good. And you used the stage while you were talking about that, so you were, that was excellent. Content, again, you talked about each table topic speaker having content. And you greeted the audience. I don't know if Will, if you greeted the audience or not, but.
Next time.
Yeah. So I think my general consensus about the meeting was that we laughed and we were competitive and everyone that evaluated somebody did a good job. And I was grateful to hear your critiques of the speakers. And that's it for now.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah,
well, oh, right. Right.
And it all.
Table talks. Toastmasters.
Contest. So we have our club contest, and now the winners, Raven and whoever is, hopefully Raven's going to be back, go on and we'll meet winners from other clubs at the next level, which is the area, and because we're centrally located, this is where it's going to happen. Okay.
Thank you, Jean. We have a competition, and we need bodies, and we need minds. We need competitive people behind the scenes to make this happen. Right now, I'm just getting basically an idea of what you guys can do here, what you guys are going to volunteer for, because you guys are so high speed. Remind me again, because it was 2 weeks ago, I was kind of busy. Who was the chief judge for the club contest? I believe
Art.
It was
Art. Art was chief judge on the club contest.
Okay. Thank you. Chief judge for this contest, would Dan be willing to be our chief judge for this contest? Or would you be?
Okay.
Now, potentially, this is all, granted, it's a week out, but it's still subject to change based on what other clubs are doing here, or what they're able to provide, by making sure we got vice to fill. Yes.
So is Ben getting people to get
yes.
to get who would consider doing the role, and then
right.
he's going to see what the distribution is across the clubs?
Correct.
Is that it?
Correct.
So Dan may or may not
Dan
actually
may not be,
do
yeah,
it.
I don't feel like this is set in stone. Obviously, I pick you. I see great things in you, and I think you'd be able to do a great job at it. And, you know, but don't take that as any kind of slight if you don't end up being the man or lady who ends up being in that particular role. For judge, I have essentially two judges here from this club. Jean. And you can round out more experience.
What are you looking for, Ryan?
Judge.
Judge number two, I'll take Emery, since you were judging in the... Would you be willing to be our chief timer, Art, for this next one?
Sure.
Okay, awesome. Okay, timer. And... Pia, you were the sergeant at arms last time. Does that mean you want to continue, or do you prefer to maybe be at alternate timer? What's your feeling? You want to do something different? You want to do kind of the same deal?
Either is fine.
What seems more adult? What more?
That's gonna follow me. I'll do the alternative timer.
Alternative timer. Okay. Okay. Sergeant at arms on Dalt. Can I count on you then? And let's see who am I?
What do you need? People that like count ballots.
Ballot counter.
Yeah.
You are on top, yeah. Sir. You obviously have the organizational skill to be a ballot counter. Yes, extraordinary.
Okay.
I think we got our people here. By Dewart.
No, I'll have a headache. The turkey's in the oven. I'll find.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
No, if you need me for something, I'm sure I can muster.
You're gonna be my.
I'm sure I can bring
yeah.
it together.
Are you inviting us for dinner Thursday?
What am I
doing?
Sure.
Okay.
Turkey's in the oven.
What am I doing?
You're gonna be the.
Okay. Sure. Sounds great.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you guys very much.
When do you want us to be here? When is it happening?
Okay. This the magic starts. Ideally, I'm here around 7:05. Get rolling.
Because we're going to do judge training and everything.
Judge training, yeah, everything starts early. I mean, you guys, everybody was here. Show of hands, was anybody not here for the club contest? Okay, same kind of deal.
And we're starting at 7:30,
yeah.
So definitely by 7.
Yeah, definitely by 7. Get here and get rolling. It's go time. Matt, my pleasure to call back up our president. Jean Symington Craig.
Well, that's really, really helpful. The division governor contacted me, and normally this would be Rick Starr. Rick Starr is our area, not governor, division. It goes prep club level, and then areas, and Rick Starr from our club is the area 92 director, and then there are four areas that are in a division, which is, we're in Division E, and that's Ben Praxel right now. So normally this would have all been what Rick would have done, but Rick is out of commission, although he went back to work yesterday, so we're hoping to see him soon. So Ben just called and said, is there someone there that, I think he was looking to see if we would do it, and I said, we can help you, Ben. And so Will, I said, I thought Will would be a good person who could help do what he just did and be the local contact, and Ben's really grateful. And I really want to thank Will for stepping up, and Will has been really great. I'll just say, is this something this has happened more than once. I'll say something, I'll ask him, and I'll say, yep, I'll do it. I'll take care of it. And it's really great to have that. So thank you for that. And again, I've already praised Andal for stepping up and helping with the youth leadership. So it's very cool when you actually step in and do something, and then you get all this appreciation, and it feels really good. I'm all about having it feel really good. Kind of like Dewart, you know, in those apartments, you know, it's just really good. No, not quite like Dewart. Dewart's way farther out on the, you know, the graph.
Five standard deviations to the right.
Yeah.
Way out of the desert, sorry.
Some of us have been there, though. We know who we are, so. What else do we want to do? So we have our Confident Leader manuals. Everyone, did you bring your $10?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, so you're ready to purchase yours?
Sure. Is,
why don't we, okay, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna let our long, loyal viewers at home, we're gonna say goodnight to them, and we're gonna do this business right now. So I'm gonna, goodnight, viewers at home.